Oh, what's up, New Jersey? Hello. I'm so glad to see such an awesome crowd for this, because every once in a while we like to do something a little different, not just have celebrity interviews all day long. Although I have to admit, these guys on this panel are celebrities in their own right. But what's really special about them is that they're like us. They're fans of horror and zombies and The Walking Dead, and yet they've taken their fandom and their obsession and they've turned it into something really special, something different for each of them. But I'm hoping that this is gonna be entertaining for you guys, because you're gonna get to see what some really hardcore fans have turned their fandom into. And maybe it might even be inspiring for some of you guys who have thought about doing something special with your particular flavor of fandom. So we're gonna have a Q&A after we learn about all these guys. Feel free to come up to the mics and ask them questions that might help you get started in whatever you guys want to do. So, with all that in mind, let's start bringing these guys out. First, he's author of Exit Zero and other zombie novels like that. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Neil Cohen. He does the Dog Walk of the Dead charity. Give it up for Anthony Musicar. Welcome. You've seen him shambling around here on the floor. He's a cosplayer. He also is this amazing special effects prop artist. Give it up for Dave Nagy. Next, we have an amazing artist who does Walking Dead tribute posters, show posters. You've seen him out on the floor. Please give it up for Kirk Manley. And finally, you may have read some of the Walking Dead novels starring the Governor and other Walking Dead novels. Writer of those and other horror novels, please give it up for Jay Bonansinga. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is awesome. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take turns going through each one of these guys. We've got a slideshow. Go ahead and please bring up the first slide, you guys, back there in AV. And I'm going to ask each one of you guys to tell me about yourself, how you got started in all of this, and where it led to. We got 45 minutes, so it's going to be fairly brief. But here we go. Do we have the slide going? I can't see it over here.
Where's tech support?
We don't see it yet. It'll come up in a minute. Okay, why don't we just get going?
Oh my God, they're all dead. They've been killed. Everybody run.
All right, this is Neil. So Neil, what you got going on?
How you doing, everybody? My name is Neil Cohen. I am the author of the Exit Zero Zombie Trilogy. Many of you have seen me. This is my fourth year exhibiting at Walker Stalker Con. My first book, Exit Zero, follows the beginning of the zombie apocalypse as it begins here in New Jersey. The second book, Nuke Jersey, follows life in New Jersey after the zombie apocalypse, and New Jersey's been sealed off from the rest of the country as they try to contain the virus. And the third book, Zombie Democracy, ends the trilogy. Follows the zombie virus has now spread nationwide. But unlike The Walking Dead, the country hasn't fallen, society hasn't fallen, the government hasn't fallen, and it is the time for the first presidential election post-zombie apocalypse. So that is the idea for the trilogy, or that was the idea behind the trilogy, but it's not really what I started out to write. So I'm gonna ask you guys, show of hands, remember how Rick used to ask three questions based on letting people into Alexandria or not? I'm gonna ask you guys three questions. Show of hands, how many of you guys loved the first season of The Walking Dead when the zombie apocalypse was just beginning? Raise your hand. All right. How many of you love Jay's books down there, which give you the backstory of the characters of The Walking Dead and how they became who they are, forged through the zombie apocalypse? All right. Now, final question.
How many
of you know absolutely, positively, without any shadow of a doubt, the reason of the Walking Dead virus, why it was created, why it was deployed, what it does? All right, see, no hands. And I'm glad no one yelled out the blue meth Breaking Bad the theory here. I am a zombie fan, have been my whole life. And there were several things that I always felt were missing from the zombie genres. And I set out because to fill those, because I was a fan, I wanted to see those stories. I didn't see them, so I wrote them. One. The zombie apocalypse always seems to immediately wipe out the United States. Why? How did we fall that fast? Rick's in a coma, and next thing you know, bam, the whole country's gone. Like a week or 2 weeks later after Shane leaves. It wouldn't have fallen that fast. I wanted to see what would happen, like in Fear of the Walking Dead, in the very beginning. When the zombie virus is coming out and something's happening and there's these weird circumstances and some people are saying it's the zombie apocalypse, other people saying, you're full of it. They don't really know, but it just keeps getting weirder and weirder and weirder until finally no one can deny this is the zombie apocalypse. Two, I wanted real people in the stories. In Walking Dead, which is awesome, you've got ass-kicking people. People that are zombie killing ninjas, or you've got the pure psychopaths like Terminus who are eating other human beings for no other reason. What happened to everybody else? Where's all the other?
They died.
Yeah, but that was the thing. But I wanted to see them die. If they're gonna die, I wanted to see. They didn't die overnight. I wanted to see normal people in their regular life with regular abilities. Having their first encounter with zombies. And so that's you'll see that all through the first book. And finally, I wanted to leave there be no mystery as to why the virus did what it did at the end of the book, end of the story. I want to know. It's always a meteor went over and there's zombies. Chemical release and there's zombies. And then, by the way, the zombies are eating people. Why? They didn't eat people when they were alive. So why are they eating people now? I wanted to tell a story where I give the virus's origin, the full origin, what its purpose was, what it was meant to do, why it was released, why it affects people the way it does, and why they look and act the way they act. So that was kind of it. I wanted to be part of this genre. I set out to basically just do anything I could, write a short story for an anthology, and it turned into right now I'm working on my fourth zombie book, and I'm following, the master over here. I'm swimming in his wake. Incredible. I'm amazed I'm not even in the same room with him as on the same stage.
Thank you, Uncle Neil.
So I've taken up my time, but if anyone has any questions, and I've noticed that a lot of times I've been at my booth and I've heard other vendors, people come up and say, how did you get published? How did you find a publisher? How did you start writing a book? They show me sketch pads. How did you become, how do people here become artists? How do they get a booth? If anyone wants to know how to do something, to move from fan to actually creating a business around zombies, around Walking Dead, these are the people on the stage here. We've got a philanthropist, we've got an actor, cosplayer, we've got an artist, and we got an author. They all have booths here. Find them and talk to them and learn how they had their path. But we're going to address a little bit of that today. Yeah. But then I yield the floor, Mr. Speaker.
Awesome. So, yeah, give it up. Woo. That was great, Neil. I think it's awesome that you saw this question that, Kirkman has said he's not interested in that, but you're interested, so you're gonna write the story that no one else is writing. How did you know you could be a writer, though?
I didn't, and I still don't. One of the hardest things, I'll tell you, if you want to start writing, the hardest thing is finding someone to read your crap. Because when you start writing, it is crap. It is garbage. And you're going to write it 5, 6, 10, 25 times. And you need someone who will give you real critical feedback on it and not just say, oh, it sucks because they're your friends and they want to bust your chops, or, oh, it's wonderful because they're your family and they want to support you. You have to get someone as critical and just hunker down and do it and realize you're going to stink for a while till you don't.
Great, thank you so much. All right, let's move along to Anthony over here. I don't even know if I said your name right. Musicar?
Yeah, you got it. Sweet. Absolutely. Like music and car together.
Okay, you have Dog Walk of the Dead.
Dog Walk of the Dead. The first thing I want to ask everybody, who has a rescue animal, dog or cat, or maybe anybody else out in the audience? So for everybody there, give yourselves a round of applause, because that's why I do what I do, so. Yeah. I'm the organizer and co-creator of an event, Dog Walk of the Dead. We're based in northern New Jersey. I started with my wife, Deanne, back in 2013. We just finished up our sixth year. We're housed up at the New Jersey State Fairgrounds in Sussex County, New Jersey. We work with an organization currently for the last 3 years called OSCAR, One Step Closer Animal Rescue. They're from Sparta, New Jersey. They're a 501c3. I've been working with them for 3 years. They've been amazing to work with. This whole thing started in 2011, which, show of hands, how many people have been to the Asbury Park Zombie Walk? The king of all zombie walks. If you guys have never been down there, it's unbelievable. They've broken the Guinness Book of World Records twice. It's an amazing setting, Asbury Park, the boardwalk and the beach. So in 2011, my wife and I attended the zombie walk because we've been lifelong horror fans, zombie fans, Halloween fans. And we went down there, we brought our dog, and we made our dog part of the costume. We got down there, and it was unbelievable. I mean, there must have been 8,000 to 10,000 people down there. It was crazy. The amount of cosplay, zombie cosplay, was the originality was amazing. So we did that, and we noticed that a lot of people brought their dogs and incorporated them into their costumes. So when we got done, we went back, and we were like, hey, you know, a lot of people, you know, are down there with their dogs, you know, as part of this. Maybe we could do something. We also attended a lot of Halloween parades with our dog and everybody. We love, you know, our dog is everything to us. So we were attending these, and they were just kind of okay, but nothing edgy, nothing really cool. So I said to my wife, I'm like, do you think anybody would be interested in doing maybe a zombie dog walk? You know, we'd gather. So I pitched the idea in 2012. I was in Montclair, New Jersey. I was at another animal event, and I met a really cool woman who ran the Montclair Animal Shelter. She was into punk rock, horror. It was unbelievable. And we were next to each other all day at this event, and I started telling her about her, and she flipped out. She's like, oh, my God, I love the idea. Would you guys be interested in, like, you know, if it would benefit us? And I'm like, oh, great. You're into it? That would be awesome. You know, so 2012, we put the idea together. And we said, all right, we're going to meet in Montclair, up and coming at this time, you know, trendy town. It was coming literally back from the dead, if anybody is familiar with Montclair, New Jersey. Everybody wants to live there now. It's amazing. So we decided to do it there, and the shelter, we were going to meet in the park, and it was just going to be, we're going to put it out on social media. Anybody that wants to dress like a zombie and show up, and we're going to raise money and for the shelter. The next thing I know, I'm getting emails from people. Hey, are you guys going to have live music playing? Hey, are you guys going to have vendors? You know, are there going to be, you know, like prizes for costumes? And the next thing I know, I'm like, oh my God, I think I'm being thrown into like actually putting an event together, which I know nothing about. So we did it. We put it together. A huge part of it was getting a friend of mine at the local rock radio station behind it too, and they were coming down, they wanted to come down, so we actually put it together in a park in Montclair. We put a call out for vendors, and I said, listen, if vendors are coming, I want, besides pet products, I want horror products, I want this to be as much about Halloween and horror as it is about pets. You know, I want to incorporate everything that we love together to do this. The radio station came down. It was a beautiful day. And, you know, by the grace of God, we had almost 800 people there, like out of just throwing it out on social media. And we raised a great amount of money. Without getting too long and winded, you know, anybody that works for rescues knows that, you know, it's pretty much... People come and go through rescues, and things happen, especially town shelters and money and programs and everything. And, you know, we actually had to move out of Montclair. We moved up to Sussex County. I started working with a new rescue up there, OSCAR. I found a great place, a building on a fairground that we could have any kind of animals we wanted there. And I had an indoor facility, 12,000 square feet. And we were able to house vendors and we were able to do costume contests. And we've added classic cars to it. So it's actually become a really big event. You know, we've just finished our sixth one. And, you know, I couldn't be prouder of my wife for helping put this together. All our friends, I mean, you know, 100% of all the proceeds that we raise every year goes right to the shelter. And I call out anybody that I know, my artist friends, to help create T-shirts and flyers to, you know, my friends that are willing to, like, work the door, work the gate, volunteer to do photography and everything. And everybody steps up. The one thing, when it comes to an animal, nobody says no. You know, when you say it's for a dog or a cat, nobody says no. So, you know, we're just continuing on, and it's getting bigger and bigger, and we want to get the word out. But if you love horror, if you love Halloween, and obviously everybody loves their dogs or cats or whatever, you know, all the money is 100% goes to charity.
What would you say is the main thing that drives you to do this? Is a lot of work. What's the main thing?
And it is a lot of work because I work on it all year round. I go to every convention that's in New Jersey, New York, you know, like promoting. You know, we're guerrilla marketing, man. We're flyers, we're stickers, we're like social media. I mean, there's no money, especially these shelters have no, all the money, you know, goes into, you know, back to the shelter. So it is, you know, strictly, you know, getting out there and telling one person at a time. This guy's been one of my biggest supporters, which I appreciate. I can't thank him enough every year. But it drives us at the end of the day, you know, when we see, you know, animals get adopted at our event or, you know, stories of everybody that, you know, had such a great time at our event, you know. Nobody's ever told me that they didn't have a good time, you know, coming to our event and getting dressed up, so.
Great. You guys, the clicker thing isn't working, I don't think. Let me just check. Nope. I want to go to the next set of slides because this is going to be amazing to see Dave's stuff. Dave, tell us about what you do.
All right, I'll do the best I can. Not much of a speaker. I'm not sure if you can actually hear me.
Make sure you get right up into the mic, like, yeah.
All right. Well, my name is Dave Nagy. I'm the owner of Dave's Dark Realm. I create human body parts. Hands, legs, torsos, you know, pretty much whatever, which I have time for. Basically, how I got started was I was unemployed at one time, so I had a lot of time to kill. And I just started messing with simple effects.
And then it's on the screen now. We got it going on there.
Yeah, there's one of my better ones. I haven't done any makeup effects in a long time except for what you see here on my face. There's something I tried a few years ago, a little more more disgusting looking, a little more realistic looking. I did a lot of research on what can possibly happen if a drill bit actually went through.
You know it's good work when you look at it and cringe.
These are, the one on the right was actually a mistake from a molding problem that I had to make the best of, and it actually became one of the best ones I ever made.
Oh, that's it. So, look at that stuff. It's so amazing. Let me see if I can go back. Do you, that looks like movie quality work. Do you actually work in the movies?
Actually, fortunately, a guy from Texas, a couple of years back, actually got a hold of me and asked to buy a few of my props, and they have been, and I think three movies now. One has been released about 2 years ago. We're waiting on the other two, and they actually, you know, one went on DVD, and there's been recently another company that bought a couple smaller parts, and actually, there was two commercials. One was a Kia commercial, and one was a Walking Dead scratch-off commercial for Washington, D.C., probably 3 years ago now. and one of my body parts was used in that commercial.
Did you start off with that goal in mind, or
no?
What were you doing when you started off? Why were you doing it?
Yeah, like I said, I was unemployed at one time, and I just started messing with some latex and some cotton, and then I just started to just do research. I get bored really easily, so I just start to just look at things probably where I shouldn't be, and watch a lot of videos. I got a hold of a great company called BrickInTheYard.com. I get all my products from there, and that's when I started to look at making body parts. And a lot of trial and error. I don't always like my work. I beat myself up really bad, not on purpose. You know, if I make something, it looks okay, but I want it to be awesome every single time.
It is.
And one thing I noticed about what you and I talked about earlier is you were unemployed. You didn't want to go find another job. You created this job. You created this company. You created the niche for yourself. You didn't go work for someone else. This was your passion. And being unemployed, you said, let's make this problem into an opportunity here. And you just took it forward.
Exactly. And I want to add one thing. As far as my costume, I really don't do a lot of makeup work. But The Walking Dead was a massive inspiration on how I sculpted my face and made it something that I can wear comfortably without me feeling too ridiculous. And I'm sure I can get better, but I feel very comfortable coming to Walker Stalker.
I want to ask you one more thing. I see you're out on the floor a lot, and it's great. You just get a chill, and you're skulking around, and from what I can tell, you don't really break character that much, if at all. I was wondering, what's your goal when you're out on the floor?
Just to entertain. I want to maybe, help out my business at the same time. If not, then I really want to make everyone have the best time possible. Even though I don't work for Walker Stalker, I'd like to just maybe help out, have people, maybe have them make like a better time here, or just, feel a little more comfortable, or because there's not a lot of me walking around. So maybe, do a little more entertainment.
Okay. Thank you for not just growling through that whole thing. All right. Let's move on to Mr. Kirk Manley, good friend of mine, amazing artist. Kirk, tell us about how you got started drawing and where it led.
I'm an illustrator, and I do that professionally as in addition to doing this stuff. And I've always been drawing since I was little. I think my first introduction to art came from comic books, and so that kind of forged my outlook on art and what I wanted to do with my life. And so I've been trying to draw ever since then. And I say try because it's it truly is an evolutionary process. Like Neil said, you just have to keep working. You never really attain where you want to go, but that's good because it just keeps driving you to get better. So I started out looking at comics, trying to trace comics, trying to copy comics and learn that style. At the same time, probably around high school, I got hooked on to Dawn of the Dead, which turned me out of Night of the Living Dead and the whole concept of zombies. And they just became a very important part of my pop culture fascination. And I tried to gobble up everything I could that incorporated zombies, but nothing ever seemed to really capture it the way that Dawn of the Dead did in terms of telling a story and the way that they treated the zombies and everything else, all the other incarnations. But then came along Kirkman's book, and just to me, that was Night of the Living Dead or Dawn of the Dead in comic book form. And it was the perfect combination of my two favorite pop culture and artistic venues. So I just became a total fan at that point. Then, of course, when they started the TV show, I had to have that, started consuming that, and that my passion for that became so strong that I started a podcast called The Biters, or biters. And I did that in conjunction with a guy that, Jeff Marzik, who wrote a comic book that I illustrated with him about a zombie, Z-Girl and the Four Tigers, which was a female zombie warrior. So we did that, and we did the podcast about the show. And, you know, again, the whole idea of comic books and the TV show, so I started to want to express myself, as I often do when I get passionate about something in pop culture. I often have to find myself often wanting to illustrate it. So I started doing these kind of almost comic book-like interpretations of the various episodes. And it kind of took the idea of the comic books and TV show and mashed them together. And I was doing that just for myself. And through the website and through posting those, I met Jason, who also had a podcast and still does, is an amazing podcaster. And we struck up a friendship, and he, you know, promoted my work, had me on his show and things like that. And then he actually introduced me to the Walker Stalker phenomena. And pretty much that was how it all started. And it's been kind of a steamroll ever since, you know? And
yeah, I mean, it seems like, I love that there's a theme here where really the fandom drives you guys. And you want to, I mean, if you're going to do something as a career, then you're going to need to make money at it. But we've all done stuff without thinking about making money just because we love it so much. And then we get bored with our regular jobs because this other stuff is so cool. Then we have to find out how to make money from it. But it's mostly the fandom. And I mean, were you a natural artist?
I wouldn't say natural is, again, it's like, you know, I compare it to any other craft or like an athlete or a musician. They don't become successful unless they practice and practice and practice. And they have to realize that, you know, they're not going to just walk on to an NFL tryout and make, you know, the New York Giants team. You know, they've got to train, you know, and they've got to develop their abilities. And it's the same thing with art. You know, no one comes, you know, just picks up the pencil and is Picasso. You know, they have to practice, they have to work at it, the craft. Same thing with, I'm sure, with what you do, you know, and in the writing as well.
And would you say that those times when you're hating yourself, like Dave was saying, because it's not good enough, that the fandom can help push you to keep going?
Oh, absolutely. And I think the passion and the love and the excitement that I get from fans and people who purchase my work and like my work, just feeds it in a way that I'm very grateful, and it inspires me, you know, and keeps me going. And absolutely
feeds the beast.
I think that, yeah, feeds the beast. I wanted to point out, you're a wonderful example of what you're trying to show people here.
This isn't about me.
I know, but it is. And I think another one that we would be at fault if we didn't mention is, I mean, we're all sitting here at Walker Stalker Con because one man who loved the show, who loved The Walking Dead, who started a podcast, decided to put this together, James Frazier, I don't know, for all those of you who know or don't know, and turned it into a company and an incredible phenomenon. So hats off to him, man.
Right. Yeah, James. Thanks. He's not here this weekend, yeah, but maybe he'll see this later. All right, let's move on to Mr. Jay Bonansinga. Tell us how you got going, Jay.
Oh, my God. I'm just blown away by all these stories, these personal stories, and I think probably everybody would agree with my feeling that every fan, every reader that comes up to my table, I feel privileged. I mean, it's corny and it sounds, you know, like I'm blowing smoke.
Very true.
But it's totally true. And I happen to know that Robert Kirkman feels the same way. In fact, that was great that you mentioned James. I'm going to go, you know, even more meta and say there wouldn't be a Walking Dead. There wouldn't be any of this if it weren't for a huge fanboy called Robert Kirkman. And he and I don't know how many of you know this, but he got the idea for The Walking Dead because of his fans' love for George Romero and George Romero movies, which have kind of a formula, but it's a beautiful formula. It's like a, it's almost like a paradigm where there's this small group, like a rainbow coalition at the end of survivors, and they're from all walks of life and all creeds and races, and they survive and they take off in a helicopter and they might end up on a desert island and the credits roll and Robert's sitting there watching Day of the Dead and they're on that desert island and they're fishing and it seems like everything's okay. And Robert thought, and then what? And then what? And The Walking Dead was born out of a fanboy's fandom and love of a seminal work, which is George Romero's work. And I'm that same kind of person. I mean, I'm the kid whose grandparents took him to see 101 Dalmatians in the early 60s. And when Cruella de Vil came on the screen, I was horrified. Her, just her bright wig hair and the long black fingernails and her laugh, her voice, and her laugh. And I jumped over the seat and I cowered in the back seat of my grandparents' car at the drive-in, Peoria, Illinois. And it haunted me for years. And finally, like maybe in second grade or third grade, I had an epiphany. The way I was gonna get through this, I was gonna get over this fear and these nightmares of Cruella de Vil with her long limousine and her mink stole made out of puppy skins. Sorry.
It's true.
Just reporting. I had this epiphany, I probably had it in Miss O'Toole's class. I would be the one that scares people. That's how I would literally, it was like therapeutic. I would be the one who scares people.
You're so nice though. How does that reconcile?
It's a facade. It's just the outer shell. I'm really a horrible black hole of a person inside.
Okay, got it. So you had that epiphany.
Yeah, and that changed my life in so many ways. I mean, again, it sounds all cornball, but it's totally true. I started wanting to be a writer. I would watch, this is going to date me, you know, but I started to watch The Twilight Zone, and I saw Rod Serling, and I'm like, that's who I want to be. I want to dress like that guy. I want to look, I don't care about all the things I have to learn, and I had no idea how to
you
write.
You are a fine dresser, by the way, I have to say.
Oh, thank you. Well, I owe it all to Rod Serling.
You don't like Batman t-shirts? I don't get it.
Yeah, I wanted to wear the little skinny ties and have little thin lapels and a funereal suit, you know, and smoke cigarettes as I introduced my stories on TV. Yeah. I just thought that was the shizit.
It's interesting how we fall in love with the trappings of a certain thing. Like, I had a girlfriend who just loved musical notes, and that's what made her, the way they written on the page.
Oh, yeah.
And so, I want to be a musician. Then you really get into it and find out whether you actually like what it's really all
yeah.
about.
Yeah, well, that's really a great point, because I think, and this goes back to, this circles back to what everybody's been saying. I think the best things in your life, the best things in your career will come out of a love of some other object of art, some other person's creation, and you love it. When I was just learning how to write, I would literally sit at a typewriter and I would copy a great novel. I would press the keys and I would just copy the sentences just to feel what it feels like to craft a sentence, you know, by these great writers, Hemingway and Faulkner, and I just wanted to feel that. And that's what all this is about, is you fall in love. I'm the young writer whose first book came out in 1992, and I got so lucky, New Line Cinema bought the rights to it, and they called my agent and I one day and said, yeah, we're just kicking around some ideas for directors for Jay's novel, it was called The Black Mariah. We're thinking about sending it to George Romero. Would you guys have any objection to that? And that started, you know, that was the next plateau for me. I got a chance. Romero loved the book. He signed on immediately. It went into a fast track development. I got to work, co-write the screenplay with Romero. He even picked me up at the airport when I went down to Florida to, you know, hang out at his house and work with him. And it's late at night in Fort Myers, and the airport's empty, and I'm standing there with my little suitcase, like Holden Caulfield and everything. And down at the end of the terminal, this big bear of a guy comes ambling toward me. This was dreamlike. I know everybody on the panel knows the dream I'm talking about. Yep. And he's like, Jay?
Yep.
And I'm like, George Romero's saying Jay. He's saying my name that's coming out of his lips and waving at me. This is not happening.
Did he have the vest and the white tennis shoes on?
I did, as a matter of fact.
No, he did.
I did, too.
Oh, really? Oh,
I did, too. I wanted to dress like, at one point, we're working, and he goes, I wanted to dress like him. It's all about dressing with me. That's the whole, that's my window into it. But at one point, he's working with me, and his producer's there, and he looks at his producer, he goes, I quit smoking on one of those films. I can't remember which one it is, but I was really grouchy. That film got really nasty, and I'm like, yeah, that was Day of the Dead. You quit smoking in 1983, and he's like, who is this kid? And who let him in here? and again, you know, I'm going back to my motif, fanboy. That is a love. You have to have, to me, you have to have that to be good at something, to master a craft, you know, and you never really know how to do it. You never really know. This is the last thing I'll say. One of the most important moments for me was just hearing this person make a speech one time at the Academy Awards. It was Akira Kurosawa, perhaps, maybe, arguably the greatest film director who ever lived. And they were giving him, you know, a Life Achievement Award, and he was an old man. He was like 80, and he waddles up to the microphone, and in his, you know, he probably practiced this in his broken English. He said these words, and he got a laugh. He got a laugh, but I believe he was completely serious. He said, this is the director of The Seven Samurai. He said, I thank you. I think I'm maybe beginning to learn how to make film. And I think he was completely serious. That inspired me greatly at that point in my life. I needed to hear that. You never are satisfied, and that's how you get better and better. You're never satisfied.
Always be a learner, always be the fool, kind of. That Steve Jobs would say stuff
yeah,
like that.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, here's one last slide with Jay's fashion sense for you guys and handsomeness.
Thank you.
Now, we have like less than 10 minutes, but I do want to, if any of you have any questions, jump up over here. Hi, what's your name? Whoever wants to jump in there.
Gold.
Nope. Oh. Okay, go ahead, yeah.
Hi, my question's for Jay. I was wondering if there's any details of the governor's life that you thought of after the books were published that you wish you had put in.
Wow, that is a great question. That's an awesome question. I mean, I remember one time I had I'm diverting and then going back to your question, but I remember one time I had the pleasure of meeting Elmore Leonard, and I asked him, Are you gonna write a sequel ever to, you know, and I can't even remember what book it was. And he said, yeah, you know, they're out there somewhere. They're doing something. Maybe I'll go find them, see what they're up to. And I thought that was fascinating. That's how he sees his characters. They live for him. And you're spot on about the governor. He lived in my imagination, and I thought of many things that, you know, I either couldn't, or, you know, I wouldn't put in the text, or that Rod, you know, they were sort of peripheral. And Robert and I even talked about stuff. We talked about, you know, I'll say that Robert will kill me if he knew this, so don't tell him. but
just,
you know,
between us.
Yeah, he. You know, the governor he believed the governor was not intrinsically evil. I don't think Robert Kirkman believes anybody's intrinsically evil, you know, but we just go down the wrong path.
TV governor or comic governor?
That's a great point. Even the comic book governor, I don't think he thought he was intrinsically evil, because he was trying to ameliorate his arch, you know, Fu Manchu, Danny Trejo, you know, broadness. He told me, you know, he had him one time, he had taking Penny's teeth out with a pair of pliers, and it was horrendous. But he did it because he wanted to be close to her. He just wanted to hold his child. And then and this is also, Jesus, Robert's gonna sue me probably after this one. But he tells his artists, a comic book artist just describes imagery, and his artist created. So Robert's very conversational. And he just said, in the next panel, I want him and Penny to be kissing. I mean, it was that flat. And he said what they came up with was completely wrong and disgusting and disturbing and creepy, because it looked like a romantic kiss. Some of you may even remember that panel. But I always thought, he's trying to make this person three-dimensional and complex, not purely evil. I don't think he believes that anybody, I don't either. I don't believe that anybody is purely evil. I think really, really nasty people have good, and vice versa. Really good people have nastiness. So we talked about his experiences when he was a kid with girls, because he ends up raping people as a form of discipline. You know, you really have to have a messed up background, or at least I said to Robert, you gotta have a messed up background to do something like that. Somebody just doesn't come up with that, you know? And Robert's like, yeah, but I don't want that in there. I don't want any of that stuff in there. I want this guy to be a tabula rasa, you know? So yeah, great question.
Thank you. You guys all rock.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have time for one more. Hi.
This is for Batman. What's your favorite piece of tribute art that you've made, and why?
I'm sorry, can you ask me again?
Your favorite piece of tribute, Walking Dead tribute art that you've made, and why?
Wow, that's a good question. I think off the top of my head, maybe the Last Day on Earth, which is them meeting Negan kind of for the first time, really, and they're all sitting at a table with a particular meal in front of them, and very reminiscent of the Last Supper. And it's been one of my more successful pieces, but it also, I think it's successful because not only because it's obviously an echo of that famous painting, but it also really applied well to that scene and what was happening there. And there were, you know, moments in that scene where Negan says, you know, I feel like I'm, I think he says, I'm sitting at the table and I'm waiting to be served or something like that. And so it just clicked. And sometimes my tributes, they don't always perfectly click with the episode. And that one I think did in a way that I've had difficulty matching. But like we've all said up here, it's a process. You keep trying to reach a certain goal, and you get close in some cases, and you're totally missed in the others. I just wanted to add to some of the other things that people are saying too, and your question, I appreciate it, but I'm going to veer off a little bit, and that is that I think we all come into this world with something that inspires us, that becomes passionate for us, whether it's movies or music or sports or art or writing and telling stories. And the world tends to push us away from that sometimes. And we end up becoming focused on making money, having a career, raising a family, all these things that are important also. But it becomes, we kind of separate it in our minds, you know, this is what I have to do 8 hours a day in order to have those an hour or two during the weekend to be able to do the things that I love. And I really would encourage people to try to give more and more time to those things that you love in your life, whatever it is, animals or art or writing.
It'll feed your spirit.
Yeah, the feed your spirit and do everything in your power to try and make that become what you have to do 8 hours a day. And you will find that there's not enough time in the day. I don't know what that is, but feedback. But there's not enough time in the day once you start to do that. I find sometimes that I'll start a piece at 8 in the morning, and I'll at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, I've been working on it all day and all night, and I have to go to sleep, and I don't want to. You know, I'm sure everybody's here had that same where I don't want to, but I have to, you know.
And your wife is like, are you ever going to come out of there?
Well said.
Thank you, Kirk. That's awesome. I totally agree with everything you just said.
Thank you for your question.
Our time is up. These guys have tables, except Anthony, but go look, Google Dog Walk of the Dead.
Right. And I have, if anybody's interested, I have a list of adoptable animals from Oscar. All their current animals. I have some stickers, so come find me.
Yeah.
And I can give you more about the information if you're in Jersey and you're looking for a dog.
Got any boxers? Any boxers?
I'm going to take a look. I'll take a look. Yeah.
Do check out all their tables. Neil brought a couple of books to give away. I'm going to end the panel and let him figure out how to do that. But right now, let's give these guys a big round of applause.
Thanks.
Thank you so much, you guys. That was super fun.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.